Good morning. Well, first I would mention, I want to mention that the all these 1 minute presentations, such a fantastic idea.
In such a short time, with the crux of the whole matter. Let's give them a big applause as a whole. We missed that. Yeah. Each one of those little ideas can change our world. It's a question of how we take it from here to the next stage. That's it, all there. I'm very delighted that I could get a chance to be here and kind of share with you all the experiences that we have gone through. Basically, my work began not as a kind of expert really trying to solve problems, as a dumb person who doesn't know anything and facing a world which is so difficult, standing in front of you. So I made my kind of objective or ambition very small, and I stay that way all the time. My ambition to begin with was to see if I can make myself useful to another human being, just one more human being, not the whole world, not the whole country, not the whole, because I felt that I don't have the capacity to do big things. But I was totally convinced that I'm capable of doing little things. So why don't I do the things that I'm totally convinced about, do the little things? And this happened because of the extreme circumstances in Bangladesh in the 70s. 1970s, Bangladesh was going through a famine. People were dying of hunger. So if you teach economics in a classroom, giving all the elegant theories, beautiful theories to your students, how the solution to all the problems are in your textbooks, then you see people are dying. It looks like a kind of joke. Things that you teach in your classroom really something which is a fairy tale, has nothing to do with the real life. So that's when I wanted to see, forget about all those textbooks and all those elegant theories. Why don't I just go out as a human being to see if I can reach out to one more human being in some way, I don't know how. So that was the beginning. And I did a lot of tiny things in the village next to the university campus. If I could make myself useful to them. And I felt a little better that yes, I have some relevance to the life of other people. Then one thing led me to something more, which was a loan sharking in the village. They take little money from the loan shark, and the loan shark kind of grab the whole life, the control of the whole life of the people. And you feel very ugly seeing these things. Day in and day out, in a very close range, face to face. And you don't know what to do. You feel so helpless. Here's an entrenched system, which you hate, you cannot do anything about it. Suddenly it came to my mind, I may not change the whole thing, but I can definitely make myself useful to a few people in this village. Why don't I lend the money myself? If I lend the money to some of them, they won't have to go to the loan sharks. Then their problem is solved. So I started lending money from my own pocket. And people loved it. They came all around me. The more I did, the more people started coming to me. So you can realize that in a couple of months, I exhausted all my money. I don't have any more money to give. So I was thinking what to do next. Because the way they were enthusiastic about it, I felt so good. It must be working for them. Then I went to the bank to see if I can persuade the bank to lend the money. No way. Bank says it's impossible. Don't lend money to work. That was the beginning of my next stage. I get furious about the banking system. For the first time, I started realizing what a banking system is. So I started arguing with them. not as an academic, just as a person, as a human being, telling them what I see their banking system is all about. I said, your banking system is very funny, because banks are supposed to be taking deposit from people and lend money to other people. That's what the bank is all about. But you created a whole institution following this idea in a very strange way. You take the money as a deposit, but lend the money to people who already have lots of money. And don't give the money to people who don't have money. I said, the logic of thing would have been, you lend the money to people who don't have the money. Once you have done that, then you go to the people who have money. Of course, bankers laughed at me. They thought, this guy doesn't understand any banking at all. So it became a big battle between me and the banks. After several months, while I'm trying to open the door, they couldn't open the door, they wouldn't open the door. So I offered myself as a guarantor. I said, I'll become your guarantor, sign every single paper, and you lend the money to the people in the village who cannot afford to get your loan. After several more months, finally they accepted it. And that's when I started taking money from the bank and giving it to the people in the village, and it worked beautifully. Then we created a bank, called it Grameen Bank or Village Bank. I had no idea that this bank will have relevance to so many people in Bangladesh. But it spread very quickly. Everybody wanted this. So it became a nationwide bank. Then people say, how did you decide on all the rules and principles of a bank? After all, you're doing a banking. How did you decide on those procedures? And I said, well, it's very simple. I had no banking experience. I never learned about banking. That was an advantage for me. So I can figure it out in my own way. So what I did, every time I look at rule or procedure, I just look at the conventional banks and learn how they do it. Once I learned how they do it, I just do it the opposite way. It worked. They go to the rich, I go to the poor. They go to the city center to do their business, I go to remote village. They work with, in this office. The first principle that we made, people should not come to the bank. Bank should go to people, so we reversed it. So nobody has to come to the bank. It's a bank's responsibility to go to the people and deliver the service. Today we have 8.5 million borrowers in 80,000 villages of Bangladesh. That's all the villages of Bangladesh. It's still the same principle. Nobody has to come to the bank. So the bank has to go to all those 8.5 million borrowers, to all those 80,000 villages, do the business at the doorstep of the workers. And it never failed. And it will be in a weekly cycle. Conventional banks are owned by rich people. If you own a bank, you know by definition these are very rich people. But we reversed it. We made Grameen Bank owned by poor people. The borrowers of Grameen Bank are the owners of Grameen Bank. Conventional banks are owned by men, rich men. We reverse that. Grameen Bank owned by poor women, because all the borrowers are women. So again, piece by piece you go, you see it's completely different. Conventional banks depend on collateral. You have to have collateral before you can take money from the bank. You say, forget about collateral. We created a banking system without any collateral whatsoever. It's based on trust. People said, trust? That doesn't exist. I said, let's discover it. Put it back again. We put it back again. It works. All this money that we give, there is no paperwork. legal papers between the other people. Since we don't have collateral, we don't have paper, legal papers, then we don't have any lawyers. Bank is the only bank in the world which is lawyer-free. No lawyer whatsoever. It works. So two things I wanted to focus on, as in my experience. You don't have to be an expert to do something what you want to do. That's why I was underlining that I was never introduced to banking as a curriculum in my work. I never learned about banking. But I did banking. I learned by myself, in my own way. I didn't follow what they did. So this is one, I think, is important lesson. Not knowing is not something of a problem. Sometimes maybe the beginning of a solution, because you don't know your mind is free. You can do things in a completely different way. If you know, you're stuck. You follow the things that you have learned. You cannot get outside. That's a big problem. And the second thing, you don't always have to follow things which exist. You can reverse it, and you get the solution. Because whatever is happening, whatever is here, is because of the system that we have created. System which creates a problem cannot solve that problem. So you have to create an anti-system. Reverse the system. When you reverse the system, it gets solved. So in banking, we reverse the system. When you hear about microcredit, you think giving tiny loans makes it microcredit. No, it's not giving tiny loans. Is it designing a completely new banking structure which makes it microcredit? At every stage, we are doing completely different banking. So this is what the thing was. And we created the bank and continued with it. And made sure it depends on its own resources. It doesn't depend on somebody else's resources. So we use savings. Everybody has to save little money. Every quarter says, we don't have money. Even if you have a tiny fraction of a penny, you put it in the bank, every week. So it became a culture with the main bank to save every week. Every woman in the main bank has her own bank account, a savings account. So she keeps on saving. That money keeps on growing. Right now, we lend out over $1.5 billion to the main bank, without any papers, without any collateral. Same system that we built 40 years back. Still the same thing. My banker friends get very worried. They say, Professor Yunus, can you sleep peacefully at night? Because you have given away so much money, you have no papers, nothing. I tell them, look, I have a very peaceful night, no problem. But I'm surprised my banker friends are losing their sleep by worrying about me. Because their mind got so stuck with the collateral, they cannot think something can work without collateral. What is the thing? This is going to collapse. They thought in the first year it will collapse, it didn't. They thought second year it will collapse, it didn't. They thought 10th year it will collapse, it didn't. Now 40th year going on, still strong, still going on. Then all these women are illiterate women. They are poor and illiterate. So we wanted to make sure the second generation in her family do not repeat the same thing history has repeated generation after generation up to her generation. Not ever going to school, not ever learning anything. So their children must have education. So it became part of the responsibility of the bank to make sure every child of the main family goes to school. It became an integrated part of our banking. So your banker, the one you know, it doesn't worry whether your child goes to school or not. But the main bank worries about whether your child goes to school. It takes its own responsibility. You take the child, make sure he or she feels comfortable going to school and stay there, not quit. As a result, the entire second generation is a
educated young people in Bangladesh. And we give them education. From government bank, it's a bank, so we give them loans, education loans, so that they can pursue the higher education as far as they can go. As a result, in these illiterate families, you have highly educated young people, professional people, doctors, engineers, PhDs, university professors, top business executives, you know, coming from illiterate families just because the door is open. When I go to village, I meet the woman who has been struggling very hard, taking small money, improve her life. She's very happy that I'm visiting her. She has been with Grameen Bank for 20 years, 22 years. She's all excited to show how much she has done. And I see a young girl with her, looks exactly like her, mother and child. And you think she must be helping her mother to do whatever she does. And I ask the mother, I asked the daughter, oh, you're happy with helping your mother is doing? She said, I wish I could help my mother, but I don't live here.
So where do you live? She said, I live in a distant district where I work. What do you do? She said, I'm a medical doctor. I'm in a clinic in a district here. Suddenly, again, I look at the mother and the daughter. They look exactly alike. But mother is totally literate, and the daughter is a medical doctor. The thought immediately comes to mind, immediately. Her mother could have been a doctor too. There's nothing wrong with her mother. Simply, society never let her go to school. And she remained an illiterate person. One institution just helped her mother, along the way helped to get her daughter to go to school. And supported her with the education loan, which she has to repay. Transformed everything in her life. She became a medical doctor. So again, it brings me to a conclusion. Poverty is not created by poor people. It's not their fault. Poverty is created by the system that we create. She is the product of that system. So if you want to overcome poverty, don't try to go pour in all your knowledge on her. You use your knowledge on yourself who created that system, who produced that poverty. Because your system has the seed of poverty. So no matter what you do, you may have a very well-intentioned person, but your machine keep on cranking out poor people. You cannot stop it. The system, what we call a capitalist system, it's like a sucking machine. It keeps sucking from the bottom and transports in the top. And the top becomes very juicy. Bottom becomes extremely dry. And that's what we call poverty. Will poverty disappear? Not if you keep the system the way it is. Because system keep on doing the same thing over and over again. So you cannot receive the result that you intend with the system which keeps on cranking the result that you see, that you want to change. When we face the poor people, as I said, about their children, I see lots of other problems. So every time I see a problem, I try to see if I can have a solution for the problem. What I did, as soon as I look at the problem of a poor family or a poor person, I try to concentrate on that aspect of poverty. And when I come up with the solution, I create a business to solve it. Every time, I try to create a business solution to a problem. And I've done one after another, many such businesses. Some of them are very big businesses, global, nationwide businesses. And people say, you must be a very rich man. You have so many businesses running for you. I said, no, I'm not a rich man. How come you have so many big businesses? I said, businesses are big. But I'm not rich. Why? Because I had no intention of making money out of those businesses. The whole intention of this business was to solve the problem. And I'm very happy that this problem is being solved. It's very difficult for people to understand how can you make business without making money. So it became a struggle for me to explain what this business is all about. And I had to try many different ways. And then they gave it a name to let people understand what that business is. I call it social business. Compared to the profit-making, profit-maximizing conventional businesses, people still find it very difficult to say. I defined it by saying it's a non-dividend company to solve human problem. It's not about making money, taking dividend from a business. It's about solving problem in a business way. And that's what the social business is all about. You can take back your investment money, but nothing more than that. We created a company, just to give an example. We don't have, like you heard an example of that, solar energy. Bangladesh, 70% of the people of Bangladesh have no electricity. So you can imagine what the problem is. Go to Bangladesh, it's all dark in the rural areas. And we work in the rural areas. It feels so sad that everybody has a little kerosene lamp, that's all. So we created a small company called Grameen Energy to bring solar energy in the village. Everybody laughed. Solar energy is not from Bangladesh, that's for Europe. I said, let's try. If people like it, why not? It's a company will be selling the solar home system. In the beginning, it was extremely difficult to persuade people to buy the solar home system. They thought, oh, it's expensive. Who wants to pay so much money for that? Selling four or five solar home system per month was such a difficult proposition. But we never gave up. We continued to make efforts to demonstrate. And finally, we sold 5 per month, 10 per month, 20 per month, 100 per month. Today, after 19 years, we sell more than 1,000 solar home systems per day. It expanded. More than 1.5 million homes today have solar energy at their homes in Bangladesh. And it will take only 3 years to make it double, make it 3 million, and then another 3 million in the next 3 years. So it expands. People like it. So that's an example of social business. We didn't want to make money out of this business. We wanted to solve problems by creating this business to solve the problems. Why did you need social business? Why aren't you satisfied with profit maximizing this business? Again, I come back to the theoretical structure of economics. I said in economics, human beings are interpreted as a kind of money-making robots. All they do in their lifetime is do business to make money for themselves. They couldn't care less what happens to the other people. As long as they make money, they're happy and they keep on doing that. So that behavior, if somebody is looking at it from another planet, they say, what, these people are busy making money all the time. They look like robots. They have no other identity as it. And I kept insisting, first of all, human beings are not one-dimensional beings. They are not robots. And worst of all, they are not money-making robots. Human beings are much bigger being than just being little robots making money for itself. So we misinterpreted human beings in economic theory. As a result, we created the world that it is. Everybody is selfish, everybody is running for money. It's a money-chasing world. We applaud everybody who makes a lot of money. Go, 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 make more money. Why? Because that's the only thing, only game in town. This is what you do, you make money. You don't ask the question, what do we do with the money? No question asked. Making money is the key thing. So it became passion. It became addiction. In addiction, you don't know why you do it, but you do it. That's what the money is. And I think real human beings are not selfish beings alone. But the economics has transformed us into selfish beings. All we look at ourselves, nothing else. So real human beings are selfish at the same time selfless beings. Both of them coexist in us. So it depends on us which one to use and which one to use, how much, in what proportion, that's all. But definitely we are not single dimensional. We are multidimensional. What we did, there's a selfish business, as money-making business, then we created a business on the basis of selflessness. That's what we're calling social business. In conventional business, money-making business, everything is for me. In selfless business, everything is for others, nothing for me. It can grow side by side. Because you have both elements. You are selfish, you are selfless. But today, economic theory has blocked out the selfless part, released only the selfish part. People say, is it really true? Why should anybody do selfless part? What is the incentive there? Why don't you become a philanthropist? Give away your money. I said, see, you want to give away money, but you're so reluctant to invest for a good cause. Why is that? Is it so strange? You say, having social business is a strange thing. If you think giving away is not strange, why should investing in a social business should be strange? It's less peculiar than giving away. I said, I want to move from the philanthropy to social business because in philanthropy, you have a good cause, and you put your money into that good cause, and you achieve that good cause. Your achievement is done. It's a wonderful idea. But in the process, your money doesn't come back. You have only one time you use of your money. But if you go through the social business route, your money goes out, does the same work in a business way. Your money comes back. So your money has a repetitive use, endless use. It never stops. It becomes very powerful. So you can achieve all the objectives of philanthropy in a business way, and you can become much, much bigger, much, much expanded, and so on, continue to do that. So that's what the business, social business is all about. You say, but you need incentive if you don't make money. Money is the incentive in the world. That's when I started saying, making money is happiness, but making other people happy is super happiness. They said, well, we don't know about the super happiness because your book doesn't have it. You learned in your textbook. You were told that money is the happiness, so you are chasing money because you want to bring happiness. You were never told in your textbook that there are businesses which change the world and gives you a tremendous happiness that you played a role in creating that business and make the world a better place. You'll be so happy doing that. But it's not included in your ideas. So you know that. So I said, you'll find out how happy or super happy you'll get by doing social business only by doing it. So why don't you take a small social business and create it and see how you feel? Then you decide, I'm not forcing, I'm not a religion. I'm not saying you do this, otherwise God will punish you. I don't say that. I'm saying these are the two options. When we put this in our textbooks, in our schools, in our colleges, in our educational institution, young people will learn there are two kinds of businesses. Business to make money, business to change the world. So people will decide which way they go. So now that idea is coming up. Many universities have opened social business centers, social business institutes in Europe, in Japan, in USA, in the Asia. So this is giving a new kind of impetus to young people to understand what social business is and how it's done, how to do that. We are doing it in Bangladesh. Many other countries are doing it in other countries. We ourselves are involved in several countries directly because we are invited to help them set up social businesses. We work in Colombia, in Brazil, in Haiti, in Albania, in Tunisia, in Uganda, the next country will be Morocco, and so on. So in India, of course. Now China is starting social business. Japan has begun, Germany has begun, France has begun. Because everybody has the same problem. Youth unemployment. In Europe, I'm sure you're familiar with that. About 50% of the young people in Spain are unemployed. 70% of the young people in Greece are unemployed. 40% of Italian young people are unemployed. And I keep telling them, what is this unemployment? Why should young people, full of energy, full of creative power, should remain wasted away? Is he not willing to work? Doesn't he have the power to work? Answer to everything, no, that's not true. He has the power to work, he's willing to work, he's very passionate about his work. Then why isn't he working? Some kind of spell has been put on him that he cannot function anymore. You are almost telling me like that. Some kind of spell. Who put that spell on him? The system put the spell on him. He cannot function. I said, do you want me to accept that he cannot function? You made him believe that he cannot function. It's like hypnotism. You put a spell and he cannot function. Otherwise, human beings are go-getters. They get things done. This is what the human beings are all about. What is this unemployment anyway? It doesn't make sense to me. But in your book, you're explaining how unemployment happens and so on. Just a fairy tale again. You create a fairy tale for yourself. You create a system which doesn't work, then you explain it away, this is the way, and you blame a human being for that. Human beings are not good. And my simple question is, should the system punish human being? Or human being should punish the system because it doesn't work for them? We are not punishing the system. We are accepting it. So the first fault we have made, first very basic flaw that we have made, we assume all people, young people like you, have to do the finish the school and has to find a job. I said, who told you so? Globally, we are rushing to get a job. Why? Are we created to become workers? Is this what the fate of human being is, to become workers? Work for somebody? I said, no, I don't accept that. Human being is a free entity. Human being is a creative entity. Human being has a tremendous potential in each one of them. But you destroy all of them. You make a petty job. Start with work someplace. And we cannot think of anything else. Come back to Grameen Bank. The young generation now, as I said, they have education, they are fully prepared, they are very frustrated. They come to me and say, we have no jobs. Why did we go to school? There's no job in Bangladesh. First, I didn't have an answer. Then I started saying, who told you you have to have a job? Is it in your book? They told you you have to have a job? Did your teacher tell you to go to a job? They get very puzzled. They thought they are supposed to be a job. Now I'm saying, who told you to have a job? Then I said, forget about jobs. Job is old-fashioned idea from old-style thinking. This is a new world, this is the world of new millennium. You abandon that idea of old stupid idea of jobs and employment. You tell yourself repeatedly, again and again, I'm not a job seeker, I'm a job giver. Behave like a job, think like a job giver, and create jobs. Can be done. Come up with ideas. Some young people say, well, I don't have an idea. What do I do? They never taught me how to do a business. I said, that's a fault of your system. Now learn about it. And you are lucky young people in coming back. Look at your mother. She took a loan of $30. She was shaking like this when first time she held this money in her hand. She couldn't believe somebody could give her so enormous amount of money. Tears rolled down her eyes. Not believing that somebody could trust her with such an enormous amount of money, $30. She dared to take that money and stand there and making sure the trust that is put in her is kept, never broken. And she did rest of her life, 22 years, repeatedly respecting that position. She worked, expanded her business, $30 to $50, $100, $1,000, and so on. And you are telling me you have no idea about business? If your illiterate mother can do all this, what good is your education? You're now asking people that you have no idea. Imagine what your mother felt like when she dared to stand up and take this $30. Shame on you. And you are lucky because you have an in-house business expert in your family, your mother. She has gone through all the struggles of building her business. Why don't you take her business the way it is right now, make it 50 times bigger because you're an educated person. Same business, it's not a different business. But give it a different shape. That's it, that's the business all about. Now what we do, we create social business fund in Bangladesh. Ask all these young people to come up with business ideas. And every day, every week, we are approving all these businesses, and we become partners. Fund, invest in your business. Whatever business you want to start. Some girl from a village say, I have a one sewing machine, I make this cloth, give me money to buy another two machines, I will rent a little space, I mean, I have a little place where I can produce all those materials, I know everything. How much money? Oh, I need $7,000. Here's your $7,000, let's go ahead, I'm your partner. So we become partners. Success of your business is my success. Failure of your business is my failure. So we work together. So we have now hundreds and thousands of these young people starting their own business. Along the way, creating many businesses. When you buy two new machines, sewing machine, you'll be hiring two new girls. Right away. And you keep on doing that. Then one of those girls said, I want to start my own business. Why should I work for her? And come to us and say, okay, here's the money. Go ahead. Continue. So human beings, to me, are basically entrepreneurs. They don't want acceptance. They said, no, it's a job. I said, no, this is work, your entrepreneurial work. We have to rediscover ourselves as an entrepreneur. Then we see suddenly a different world, completely different world. Our thinking is different, our creative power. Each one of them you presented is a seed of a huge, huge businesses, social business.
Social business doesn't have to be a mega business. It could be a tiny little business. Like, for example, I want to solve the problem of unemployment. There are millions of unemployed people. How can I do that? I said, don't worry about millions. Just pick three, just pick four. Four, I create a business to absorb four unemployed young people. So that they will have decent salary in my business, they will earn enough for the business. So
the business will be in profit. They can return my money, still I will own the business, but rest of the profit will be plowed back into it. So that they can hire another person, we can put back. If I have found that business model, I have discovered a miracle seed. When you have a miracle seed in your hand, all you have to do is to grow it again and again so that you can make a big plantation. So that is the power of this little ideas. These are miracle seeds. Once we do that, we change the whole world. So we can create a world where there's not a single person who will be a poor person. Bangladesh has already achieved that Millennium Development Goal of reducing poverty by half. We achieved it in 2013, June of 2013, 2.5 years before the terminal date of 2015. We have done that. The natural question is, when should we reduce it to zero? And I keep telling everybody, we should reduce poverty to zero in Bangladesh in 2030. Then in 2031, January, we'll put a big ad in the newspaper. If you can find one poor person in Bangladesh, $1 million award. And I tell them, make sure nobody can win that award. Because they cannot find any poor person in fact. It's possible. So all you have to redesign things, that's all. If you can come down to half, remaining half is very easy. You just continue what you have been doing. It's a very natural thing to come to say, you cannot escape that. So let's put all our forces together to make it safe. Then in 2031, we'll create a poverty museum. Because nobody in the country will ever know what poverty is. So we'll take the children to the poverty museum to show what poverty used to be like. And they could believe that people had to suffer so much for no fault of their own. And I said, same thing can happen to the unemployment. We can create a world where not a single person will be unemployed. In that world, people will be asking each other, what is unemployment? They don't understand the word unemployment. No, we learned in the history, they used to say unemployment. What is it? They couldn't work. Why didn't they work? Because they were sick. No, they were not sick. They were healthy. And then why didn't they work? Because nobody had. Why did they wait for hiring? Couldn't they do something for themselves by doing something? They would never understand why so many people are unemployed. They couldn't understand why one single person is unemployed. So in that world, the very word unemployment will become unemployed. Because there is no use that word anymore. Thank you very much.
Interested in taking money for himself or herself. That's all. It's a kind of special state of mind. This is what I want to do. What I want to do, I want to solve the problem of these five unemployed young people. So I'm concentrating on that. I'm not interested in making money. If I'm interested in making money soon, I will not be interested in four or five people because I have more opportunities of making money than millions. So we have to cut off that point. We get interested in those four young people who I'm trying to get a solution to their employment.
So how many social businesses do you have so far?
Many. I have created more than 60 social businesses in Bangladesh. For example, that's what I'm doing. But I was trying to give in some of the information why multinational companies became interested. Like, for example, Danone, we created special yogurt to solve the problem of malnutrition. Danone is not interested in making money. Let me give you a quick example of that, that will be the breakdown of things. When we created this company with Danone, this is 1 million euro company. And half will come from Grameen, half will come from Danone.
And we've gone through very elaborate preparation. When the company is registered, we put our €500,000. But Danone could not put their €500,000. So we waited for weeks, we waited for months, the Danone money doesn't come in. So we thought maybe they changed their mind. So we talked to them on the phone. They said, no, don't worry about it. Our lawyers are standing on the way. Our lawyers raising the question, shareholders gave the money to the management to make money for them. Now, management is putting this money into a fund, into a company in Bangladesh, which tells upfront they will never give any dividend. So there will be a violation of the mandate of the shareholders. You cannot use shareholders' money to do that. So I said, then what happens? So no, don't worry, we'll find a way to find this. So about 3 months later, they had their annual general meeting of all the shareholders. There are more than 300,000 shareholders. Before that, they sent a letter to all the shareholders of Danone, telling how the company is successful, it's a lot of money, their dividend is so much from the Danone company, and so on. At the end, they said, we are trying to find €500,000 to put it in Bangladesh, in this particular project, to solve the problem of malnutrition. We cannot use company money. So if, as a shareholder, as an individual, if you're interested to put your money into that, you feel free to
put a check in that and say what percentage of your dividend that you're receiving you would like to invest in that company. And reminding you that that company will never give you dividend. 98% of the shareholders signed up. Total money they got was €35 million. They were looking for only €500,000. So when you go to people, you'll be surprised what you say, nobody will be interested. This is what they prove. Not only they did get €35 million, every year now they put money into that fund, they create created a whole social business fund and creating more social business around the world with that money which people put there, invest in social business.
I think this is a perfect answer to one of the questions here. How can you manage, or what is the formula to change a shareholder to a stakeholder? And this is what you have done. Okay, we have also a group of questions related to, we hear the many of the success stories, and we would like also to know about the challenges you have faced with different organizations, with the government, to make this success story.
Business means troubles. Whether you are doing for profit making, whether you are doing for social business, you have uncertainties, you have problems. Entrepreneur means who comes with solutions. That's what the entrepreneurship is all about. You come up with solutions and solutions. So don't think business means it's a smooth sail at the moment. It doesn't. Even the norm, the one that I just mentioned, had so many problems in implementing this product. Because after we created it, after we launched it, we started selling the product, suddenly 2008 financial crisis began. All the prices started going up. All the milk prices in the whole world went up, it became double. And yogurt is nothing but milk. So we are under pressure to, we wanted to make it very cheap. Now we are under pressure to put the price to double. So we have big struggle. So finally you put the price double because otherwise we cannot survive. And the whole yogurt set stopped. People are not interested in buying it anymore because poor people cannot afford that. So we had to struggle with it, count many solutions. Finally we came up the technology solution. We created the yogurt using less milk, more cereals. But it's still the same yogurt, same taste, same everything. Bring down the price and so on. So, okay. So you keep on coming with one or the other alternative, all the problems. You come up with the creative solutions. That's what the beauty of the human being. They always have creative ideas how to overcome problems.
We have also a group of questions related to Grameen Bank. First, what is the definition of poverty? The other one is related to, did the trust in people change by time? I mean the question here from 70s till now. And what's your approach with the people who are not able to pay back their loans?
But the poverty situation has changed overall in Bangladesh completely, as I mentioned, with the Millennium Development Goal. Used to be 85% poverty in Bangladesh. Today we have come down to below 25% poverty in Bangladesh. It's a big chunk for us to do that. And it's continuing very quickly. And of course, with the Grameen Bank families, they have moved out, they have their homes, they have their toilets, they have their drinking water facilities, etc., etc. And their children went to school. So we have kind of indicators for each family to see at what point a family moves out of poverty. So we have 10 indicators, what kind of house she has now, what kind of drinking water access she has, what kind of sanitation she has, what kind of warm clothing she has for the family, furniture in the family, children going to school, how much money she has in the savings account. I said, we gave out $1.5 billion in loans every year. Today, all the borrowers put together, total savings in their account is nearly $2 billion. So this came out of nothing. So gradually, she built up her own money. This is her own money, this is not the loan.
So at the beginning, how did you treat these cases that they were not able to pay back?
Oh yes, I'm coming to that. Yeah. The way we designed Grameen Bank, the first principle of Grameen Bank was, we will not penalize anybody for not performing according to this expected procedure. So there is no system of punishing, penalizing anybody. We trained the young two group when the five people joined the group. One of the training issue is, what happens to if one of the borrowers could not pay back money? What would be the role of the four other friends? When they said, no, we make sure we'll work with their families, put pressure on them so they should pay. No. He said, that's not a Grameen Bank. If somebody cannot pay back, first reaction you should have as a friend, oh my God, she's in trouble. As a friend, your responsibility is to help her, not get angry with her. Getting angry doesn't solve problem. So you find out what is the problem which caused her not to pay back. And you'll be amazed by the problem, the cause you explained. One cause would be her husband took the money and just disappeared. You know, what does it good do good to her if you get mad at her? You should be sympathetic with her. You should be finding out where her husband disappeared. If you cannot find him, ask your husbands, because they are friends too, to go and grab him. They know where he could be. Go and catch him, particularly with the money, grab him, so that he can bring it back. Or her cow died. She couldn't pay back anymore. She bought a cow with the money. Now the cow died, she cannot pay back anymore. So you should be giving all the sympathy, and bank will give the sympathy. Getting angry with her will not solve the problem for her. You will only make her life more miserable. So our basic principle of joining money in bank should never make her more miserable than she was before. So if you become more miserable, then coming back is a failure. So she must feel comfortable that she's with good friends and they're always helping. So if her cow died and you come back to us, say that we need another loan for her, then we'll give you a fresh loan. And if she wants another cow, still give a fresh loan to another cow. So the first loan will not be forgiven. First loan will become a long-term loan. You can almost forget. Second loan becomes a valid one. Suppose you are paying 100 per week, and we'll talk to her, you talk to her, and she add a little bit more. Instead of just 100, she can give it 105, 102, 106, whatever. Then this extra 6 will be on the second, the one debt card, whatever time it takes.